Line and Length in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty.
Hello, welcome to Line and Length in association with Massey Realty. I'm your host, Andrew Seeley, and joining me from England, I'm not sure if it's Cole or if it's what, is former West Indies opening batsman, Phil Wallace. And hello to you, Phil.
Hi, Andrew. Thanks for having me yet again on the program. Today's a very nice day in England, actually. The sun is shining, so it's a very good day. Yesterday was not so good. It was very cold and wet, and obviously, but today is a good day.
Okay, well, it's a good day or not. The county championship season has started, and defending champions Surrey are up there again, as always, apparently. Surrey's always among the top in Division 1. Some other teams have done particularly well, and then in second division, Yorkshire, which has the West Indies ODI captain Shea Hope in tow at the moment. They lost out in their first game, and then their second game was rained out. So how has the season gone so far? I know you must have watched some of the cricket. How has the English County Championship season gone so far after two rounds?
Well, Andrew, I have interest in the county, in county cricket. I have interest at Surrey because I'm a member, and also Kemar Roach is there. And Gloss, and at Yorkshire, because my former teammate and schoolmate, Otis Gibson, is the head coach. And yes, Shea Hope is there. We had a little chat about Shea Hope. Otis is a very big believer in Shea Hope's ability, and he's been given the opportunity. Mind you, his three first-class games. He started well in the first one. He got 83. He didn't convert that into 100. Yorkshire, that first game, Yorkshire lost to Derbyshire. The first time they lost to Derbyshire since 1910. So it's not a good start for Yorkshire, but Otis is still very optimistic, very positive. That he will come up from the second division and come up into the first. And obviously the game that they played last was supposed to play last week at Gloucestershire, not a ball bowl. So it just tells you how much rain was in that part of the country. I've been to Surrey at the Oval, the K Oval on Friday. I got an opportunity to get down there. It was off and on, you know, stop start kind of thing. But then I got to go up and speak to Kemar Roach. Yorkshire, their first game. I mean, Surrey, their first game was away. In Manchester against Lancashire, and they held on there for a draw. But then they came home to the Kia Oval. A very good surface, I must admit. I spoke to the groundsman on Sunday, myself and Monty Lynch and another guy called Matthew Atkins, and we went down there. But I spoke to Roach on Friday, and he was telling me how happy he is that Surrey settled in quite nicely. He's been here now for two or three seasons, Andrew, and the Surrey County has really embraced him. I spoke to CEO Stephen Elwordy, the former South African fast bowler, in the presence of Kemar Roach. Everything seems to be going quite good for Kemar. He has a week off this week because they're not allowed to play three games back-to-back. So they played two,
okay.
7 days off, and then the next game is against Warwickshire up in Birmingham, and then they go down to Essex to play Essex at Chelmsford. And I only learned on Sunday night, some years ago, Essex bowled out Surrey for 14. So that's a grudge match. And then when they come back to the Oval in May, they have their next door neighbours, the rivalry between Middlesex and Surrey.
So,
the championship has started well. Pope, I have a very big interest in Pope. I like him as a batter. So he got 100, he played wonderfully well. He got a 90-odd in the first innings and then went on to win the game for Hampshire in the second innings. So it's a good start for Surrey, and we just hope that they can continue to build on that.
Okay, Phil, tell us a bit about the response to the start of the county season. As you mentioned, obviously, it could be a little cold and there's been rain about. But with England performing so well, what has the response been like across the country?
Yeah, well, when I went down to the Oval on Sunday evening, a lot of people had travelled up to Lancashire to watch that first game. Because a lot of these counties, Andrew, have the real heart, so true-hearted supporters that will travel the length and breadth of this country to watch their county. And a good set of people from Kia Oval, from the Surrey County, went up to Old Trafford. And then on Sunday, with Surrey obviously looking to win that game, which they eventually did, and Ollie Pope batted wonderfully well. There were about 500 or 600 people watching the final day spin on Sunday at the Oval. Mind you, the Oval is in London. It's not as cold as in London as it is maybe up north. But at least to get 500 or 600 people watching the county final day spin is good. I thought that the surface at the Oval was a very good surface and allowed for good stroke player. And again, the interest in Ollie Pope and how he's batting, Andrew, I must admit, I spoke to Roche and I told him that in my era, he would get knocked down if he was facing the Paris and Thompson, because he runs at the fast bowlers. And he has brought that style of that Baz ball into county cricket. And okay, a lot of people are warming to it. A lot of people are warming to it. And obviously, he's continuing that vein. And it has worked for him thus far.
Okay. In terms of West Indians in the UK in county cricket, 20, 30 years ago, we would have had so many. You mentioned Holt, you mentioned Roach. Otis Gibson is the coach at Yorkshire. But apart from that, no West Indians at all. But we have a plethora of Australians and South Africans. And those who probably didn't make it to the IPL or who wanted to play longer form cricket, they are in England for the county championship. But we can't get any more than a handful of West Indians.
Well, Andrew, today I met four West Indians, but they're all over 60. So I sat with more West Indians that are playing. I sit in Saturday with more West Indians, and what are playing in the county championship. There's only Sheer Hope and Roach, to my knowledge. It is just a reflection of where West Indies cricket are in relation to the world. And in England as well, Andrew, once upon a time, this used to be the breeding ground for all cricketers. A number of cricketers would have come over to this country and played a lot of league cricket and obviously played county cricket as well. But that has not happened. And we only have two. And I do hope that they continue to let the light shine and do well so that they can open the doors for more Barbadians and more West Indians by extension. I know there's Kieran Powell up here. He's going to be playing for a club as well. I know he's in the Caribbean at the moment, playing that Headley Weeks tournament that Cricket West is put on. But he's also going to be playing some league cricket up here. But he lives in England. So there isn't a lot of West Indians like years gone by, maybe 15, 20 years ago. You know, you had a lot of guys in the leagues. So everything now is being centered around the Australians and the South Africans. They have taken up a lot of the international overseas postings in these counties and also in league cricket.
A challenging one for you here now. There's been some controversy in terms of so many Australians playing county cricket as they get ready for the Ashes 2023. And some English pundits have suggested that counties ought not to have incorporated Steve Smith and the others, Matt Renshaw and the others, because they'll be too ready for the England team when the Ashes start.
Yeah, but Andrew, they're professional cricketers, and the counties want to get the best players into their county setup as early as possible. You know the difficulties of playing in England in April and May. It's always damp, the ball swings around. So they're looking for the best cricketers who are available to come in the early part of the summer, as they call it, to really try and solidify the start of the county season. So they look for the best players. It used to be the West Indians, Andrew, but our batters are not capable enough at the international level, so they're not getting the opportunities at the first class level here in England. So they have to turn the tables to who they want. And at the end of the day, they're going to employ the players who are going to bring value. And I'm speaking for value for money, and also bring players and spectators through. When you look at Durham, Marcus North is the guy up there running the cricket, and Ryan Campbell, who used to be the coach of Netherlands, a former Australian player, he's now the coach at Durham for 3 years. So the Australians are, yes, in England, they're obviously bringing in their own, and that is expected. Home drums must be first, and that is what is happening here in the UK in relation to the first class cricket and also in the leagues.
Okay, Phil, we're going to come back in just a moment here on Line of Length, and when we come back, we're going to talk about Brendan McCullum. He's in a bit of a pickle at the moment, although we haven't heard much from the England and Wales Cricket Board as yet on the whole controversial betting matter. When we come on Line and Length in association with Massey Realty.
Line and Length in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty. The new Calvin Hawkins Custom Services, located at Crystalline Hub, is opened and serving clients daily on the corner of the Mighty Griner Highway and Brighton Road. There's a wealth of fantastic services, including customs brokerage, delivery, logistics, small package service by Easy Shop, featuring Kestrel Liner Agencies, Consolidations and Logistics, CSASH Container Haulage and Transportation, and MC Yacht and Shipping, Cold Storage Warehousing, Yellowfin Water Sport Activities, and more. Calvin Hawkins Custom Services, now open at Crystalline Hub on corner of Mighty Griner Highway and Brighton Road, working day and into the night.
Ready for these batting lessons today? Let's do it. She tell me, hit it, oh, you're missing so. Hit it, you used to brag before. Hit it, if you could handle me. Hit it, hit it and let me see. Hit it, hit it in the corner. Hit it, hit it in the cover. Hit it, hit it in mid wicket. Hit it, hit it, hit it.
What did you do again?
I think you best stick to that.
Join me in the next segment where I show you what we're good at.
Line and Length in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty.
And welcome back to Line and Length, and I'm your host, Andrew Seeley. Continuing to join me is Philo Wallace from the UK. Philo, Brendan McCullum has endorsed 22 company in India that sponsors part of the IPL. It appears to be going against a contract that he signed with the England and Wales Cricket Board, but the England and Wales Cricket Board have not said anything further as yet. Your thoughts? ECB doesn't want to get rid of McCullum at all, I don't think.
I don't think the ECB wants to get rid of McCullum for a very long time. He's brought changes to their test match cricket. Ben Stokes, a new captain, has endorsed what Brendan McCullum has brought to England test match cricket. And Rob Key, who's the man in charge of England's cricket, he, you know, it would be a surprise to him as well. It was to me to understand that Brendan McCullum, you know, is involved or his name has been called around betting. We know what that means in international cricket. That is a big capital N and a no. And apparently they found out 6 months after he signed the contract. But again, the ECB will be professional, Andrew, as the unit they are. They will get down to the nuts and bolts about it. They won't spill any beans until they have real concrete evidence. And then they will come up with a decision that is best for England cricket. But at this moment, yes, you haven't heard a lot about it because they're working behind the scenes to make sure that they get what all the evidence and get all the answers to the questions before they come out and make a statement. But it's a shock. For the England cricket, it's a shock for the England squad that obviously they have to get a squad together shortly for the Australians. They have already announced their Ashes squad and the squad for the Test Championship. So that would have put a little block on the ECB. But I believe that they will do what is right and handle this whole situation with Brendan McCullum in a professional way that they should. And obviously come out as a win-win situation. Just unfortunate, Andrew, because we don't know who was Brendan McCullum's manager and what they were doing before he joined the England squad and what he was doing in the IPL. So these are things that could have been there before he signed that contract, and it's just an unfortunate situation for him and the ECB.
Were you surprised when you heard that McCullum had endorsed 22 bet? It would seem to me to be a no-brainer for an international cricket person have signed that type of contract, but were you surprised?
I'm very surprised, Andrew, that a former international player, a former captain of New Zealand cricket, would endorse a betting company. We saw what happened to Shakil Al-Hassan out of Bangladesh, but he refused to declare his interest within a betting organization. And the ICC is quite clear. We don't want that kind of entity around our cricket. We don't want no cricketers in the international setup being affiliated with anything dealing with betting. They don't mind if you beat the bowling, but they don't want you to bet on games or even go walk close to a betting shop. So it's something that surprised me. And Brendan McCullum being the professional that he is, I believe it could be an oversight. Maybe it's something he did not declare because he should have declared his interest, or he has intentions to be part of and try to see if he can get out of it before going into the international arena. But he's done so well, they don't put the ECB in a quandary if it is true. Because are you going to get rid of a coach who's coming and hit goal? You know, and then you have the Ashes, which is massive. Bigger than World War One, bigger than World War Two. The Ashes, the both countries are going head for head. So I think it is a very peculiar position that the ECB has found themselves in. And obviously Brendan McCullum as well. And we just hope that he and his management team and the ECB can come to a conclusion, sooner rather than later.
And if we talk about that same IPL now, Philo, obviously you've been watching. I don't think there's anybody in the world that loves cricket who has not been watching it because it's just literally everywhere and in your face. Sometimes you're not even sure which game you're actually watching, if it's live or if it's a game that was played yesterday or 2 days ago. So I know you've been watching some of it. Your immediate thoughts on what has gone on for the past 2 to 3 weeks in the IPL?
But the IPL, Andrew, is action. It's very fast cricket. If you blink or move away, you miss all of the action. I think that the players are showing commitment. There's a lot of bravery, I call it, in that cricket. Teams are not giving up, which is good to see. They're fighting down to the bitter end. And a lot of sixes, a lot of fours, there's a lot of excitement. And one thing you can say is that those players who have been bought for the big bucks are really performing. And I would just hope that we saw Hetmer a couple of days ago, been in the game for Rajasthan Royals today. He flunked out. He didn't do anything today. And these are things that still bothers me. You know, we need to be consistent. Our players need to try and find consistency within the IPL setup and try to be as professional as possible ever so often. There are about 10 or 12 of our players, but not many of them have been given opportunities. Our T20 captain as well is a concern to me. He hasn't even got off the market. His franchise is struggling. And those kind of things are quite set you back as a cricketer. But I think that the IPL, they know what they're about. They have some very professional people around. Sunrisers is being coached by our great Brian Larry. And obviously we want to see that franchise do well also. And Jason Holder continues to hold his own. I believe he can put in a bit more. But it's good so far. I think the excitement in the cricket is there. The fans are certainly loving it. One thing I don't like about the IPL, Andrew, is this, they call him impact player.
On the impact player, you don't like it, yeah, Philo. Yeah. But Philo, if I were your captain, as soon as you finish batting, I'd put you to sit down. Bring in the impact player.
it has me confused, but it's part of the innovation now in the IPL.
Right.
And we'll see how that goes down the future for cricket. You know, but it seems to be working. The players, the franchises, and the players seem to have warmed to it. But I think it's something that is just baffling to me, where you can just substitute a fella and bring someone else in to do something special. But it is working. It's new innovations, and the IPL obviously are going to set the bar quite high and continue to look to control T20 cricket around the world.
You mentioned impact player. Philo, imagine Rohit Sharma was an impact player in a game earlier this week. Can you imagine Rohit Sharma being an impact player?
But Rohit Sharma is an impact player, even if he's not one brought in as an impact player. The way he bats, he's impactful. He's quite good. He's very experienced at leading, at winning as well. And he's now starting to step up the ante for Mumbai Indians. We have Pollard, who is there as their batting consultant. Dwayne Bravo is with CSK. CSK continues to show glimpses of being brilliant. But then sometimes they're caught in their tracks. But I think that when you look at Sharma, he's obviously a world-class player. And one thing I like about him, he's adaptable. He does everything for the franchise. If they want me to be an impact player, I'm going to be an impact player. And I think he's quite flexible. And I like the way he handles himself and handles that entire Mumbai Indians franchise.
Okay, thank you so much, Philo Wallace. As usual, some insightful thoughts there on world cricket. And you're watching Line and Length, and we'll be right back in just a moment.
Line and Length, in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty.
Welcome to Realty Check with Massey Realty. This is going to be a series where we're going to discuss everything there is to know about real estate here in Barbados. So, you've now come to the realization that you're not getting any younger, and it's about time that you purchase your own piece of land or your own home. So the first thing that we always ask you to do is to make sure you know exactly what you qualify for. So that's an easy process. You just call your preferred bankers, tell them that you are going to be looking to purchase a property. They ask you a series of questions, and then they will provide you with a mortgage certificate. And believe what I tell you, this saves a lot of time, especially when you're working with real estate agents as well.
Taste the fantastic flavors of fruits, sweetened or unsweetened options. Choose from golden apple, tamarind, passion fruit, five finger, soursop, sorrel, cherry, and much, much more. Fruits, juices, and punches featuring pumpkin, carrot, and beet. Look for us at your favorite supermarket, and we also supply cafes, hotels, bars, and restaurants, and now catering to family events, social clubs, and corporate functions. Fruits, fantastic and flavorful. Line and Length, in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty.
So welcome back to the program. Thank you so much, Andrew. With me now, of course, is our very popular Barbados Cricket Association segment. And with us is the head of marketing for the Barbados Cricket Association, Stephen Leslie. Stephen, last week we had so many people around the region looking forward to the start of the local BAT20 tournament. It did get off to a fantastic start. Let's first of all recap, how did things go in the first week?
Last weekend was everything that we dreamed of here at the Barbados Cricket Association. We had many schools and clubs across the island going and actually playing their trade as it came to the T20 segment of our competition. One of the beautiful things about T20 cricket, as you know, you get a result on the day, and we had the defending champions, UWIA, actually recording two victories over the weekend, both on Saturday and Sunday. The same can be said of other clubs, Gladiola, YMPC, Pickwick, and Wilde. So those five clubs in the opening series of matches have really done justice to the preparation that they would have been doing over the last few weeks. And there were some really exciting performances. We had a record-breaking century, 150 not out Windward Club being made, and then a century also being made during the course of the season. Now, Jafari Toppin is a young man who actually made that 150. And Barry, he struck some 15 sixes in that innings of 150. And as it stands, that is the highest individual score ever recorded in a BCA T20 championship. And with a start like that, we are just hoping that both his club, Windward, and his form can continue during the course of the year.
How exciting is it, though, to have, you know, being, you know, in the middle of a drought, really, in Barbados, it's been so dry, but, you know, you have cricket being played in the T20 level ahead of the CPL, because that's one of the main reasons that the BCA decided to play at this particular early stage. How exciting is it to be actually out playing cricket, considering that a year or two ago, we were all inside playing cricket, perhaps on PlayStation?
PlayStation or marble cricket, Barry. The reality is that we are extremely excited. And the drug that Barbados is experiencing, I think the Barbados Met Service came out and suggested that we shouldn't expect too much rain between now and June. So we had to get on with our business. We had to get on with the allowing schools and clubs and all of the talented cricketers to get out there. And really, I believe that everyone is really pleased to be playing cricket again in the more conventional way, where you can interact with your friends and your club mates, and also those who are visiting and playing against you. So it is a very important part of the social fabric of what we do here at the Barbados Cricket Association. And between April until December 17th, we'll be playing different formats, but cricket is a game that we all want to be able to bring the excitement to those who are following the game.
Let's talk a little bit about the other tournaments and other competitions coming up. T20 is on its way. It's going really well. Second round this weekend. Let's talk about some other things happening. What about the under 13 competitions and other tournaments for the youth? What's going to be happening there? And tell me about what the BCA is planning.
Well, Barry, the BCA Sir Everton Weeks under 13 tournament, which is played among our secondary schools, will commence in the first week in May. And this year we have introduced a Barbados Cricket Association ladies under 19 team. And what is critical about that is that among these under 13 players, this BCA ladies on 13 team will have the opportunity to rub shoulders with their boys. And it's obviously to generate interest and to aid in the development for women's cricket on the island. So this is something that is going to run from the first week in May until the end of May. We have most of our secondary schools participating, and it's really another exciting project that the Barbados Cricket Association is endeavoring to execute during the course of May 2023.
You talk about women. We've been saying that women's cricket is not developing as it should because there's not enough of it being played around the region. What is the program like for women in the BCA's tournament? How many tournaments do you have, and how are women coming through the ranks?
Well, the three main avenues, and I'll start with the Sir Everton Week Centre of Excellence, which provides our under-19 ladies and our senior ladies with at least three training sessions with the main coaches here at Kensington Oval per week. So that session is pretty much held between the January to March period. It then is a short break. Then we come from April to June. Then we resume from September to December. So pretty much about 7 or 8 months of a year, these ladies are here at Kensington as part of the Sir Everton Week Centre of Excellence. When it comes to the females, we also have the Iris Walker Women's Tournament, which is played with two Barbados Cricket Association teams and also the University of the West Indies. This is typically played between the months of January and February, is in the T20 and Super 50 format. And this is something that we do on a continual basis between those months. And then, Barry, we have a representative Iris Walker team that plays in the domestic competition that, as you know, runs from April to December. And these women play where this year Shakira Salmon has been named captain. They will play all three formats against the men. So they play first the T20, then they go into the 50 over, and then it goes into the two-day format. So our women are given plenty of opportunities to be exposed and be part of the important development for women's cricket in Barbados.
I must also ask you, Stephen, about other things going on with the and other tournaments and stuff you're planning. We also had an unfortunate death with a member of the Empire Club. You want to tell me about those two things before we wrap up?
Well, I'll start with the death. I don't want to bring too much information out yet, but we did receive on social media the death of one of the leading club men at Empire Club today. He's a very young man, and I'm a member of Empire Club, Barry, and when I saw it circulating, it was certainly something that has, you know, saddened me. And when all the information is out, I will be in a position and others to state his name, because it hasn't been made fully public as yet. But yes, that unfortunate death. And I believe that he was also involved in actual cricket on the opening round of matches, which was last weekend. So this comes as a shock to most of us. And as it relates to, Barry, what the BCA wants to do, we are going to hopefully in the summer months continue with what we know as the Under 15 Boys Tournament. And we are likely to use a different format, meaning that at Cricket West Indies, there have been some adjustments made to the age groups. So even though we call it Under 15, we hopefully will consider lining it up in line with what Cricket West Indies is doing. And that tournament runs for the summer months between June and August. And along with that, there's then a 19 limited overs tournament that is going to be scheduled for the October, November months of this year. So there's plenty of cricket along with the club season. And as I said to you before, and I say to many others, there's a lot of organized cricket. The excitement is there, and we hope that these young men and women can develop their full potential.
Well, wonderful stuff. Well, thank you so much, Stephen. We'll be joining you next week. We'll have some great footage as well from the T20 this week. And we hope that that tournament can continue like how it has started in a very exciting fashion. And we'll be joining you next week for a special segment. Thank you so much, Stephen Leslie, Head of Marketing at the Barbados Cricket Association.
Thank you very much. Have a good afternoon.
Line and Length in association with Massey Properties ProClean and Massey Realty.
You're watching DBS.